Having a wonderful Friday morning. I just want to welcome each and everyone who has joined me this morning. I just want to say blessings to you all. I'm happy you are able to join me this morning. And you know, I really hope that what the Lord has led me to speak about this morning will certainly find fruitful ground. Before I begin though, let me just whisper a word of prayer and then we'll get right into it. Let's pray. Holy God, righteous Father, we come before you this morning humbly at your feet. I bow. Lord, I know that you have ordained this moment. I know that you have set this moment before the foundation of the earth. And Lord, I pray even now, as your people are gathered virtually, that you will be in the midst of us. Lord, let nothing be done of self. Let nothing be done to my or anyone else's glory, but to your glory and adoration. Lord, I pray that you will continue to speak through me. I pray that you will rid us of all distraction or detraction, even now. In your holy and precious name I pray. Amen and amen. So, again, I want to welcome those who I'm seeing on. I'm seeing Miss Simone Dennis, Veronica Brown, Michael, Diane Thompson. I see Pastor on. I see Brother Ity on. And Eulalie Davis, Paula, Ewan, Dorothy Patterson. So I just want to welcome Sister Anne-Marie as well. And so I just want to welcome everyone who is on this morning. And whether you're from the Greater Portmore Tabernacle or any of the other churches in the JM, or if you're not attached to any church for that matter, whether in the JM or overall, we want to welcome you. I want to welcome you this morning. And this morning I want to speak about the song that was played earlier. But the topic that I have selected this morning, as you would have realized this week, there is no particular theme or topic that all of us are speaking on. So each person has spoken on, you know, what the Lord has laid on their heart. So this morning I want to speak on a topic which I call purpose in pain. Purpose in pain. And the song I played earlier, It Is Well With My Soul, or It Is Well, as some would put it. It was written by Horatio Spafford. And many persons don't know that the story behind the hymn is of loss, is of tragedy, and of extreme pain. Let me just give you a little about the story of Horatio Spafford. So in 1871, Spafford was a prosperous lawyer and a devout Presbyterian church elder. And his wife Anna, they were living comfortably with four young daughters in Chicago in the US. And in 1871, a great fire devastated the entire city where Spafford and his family lived. In fact, it is said that Spafford's fortune was evaporated or went out in smokes, just like the fire, based on the fact that he invested heavily at the time in real estate. So essentially he lost everything overnight. 2 years later, the family decided that they were going to vacation or take a trip to Europe. I guess with all that happened, you know, the whole loss of his estate and other things, you know, he decided 2 years later that, you know, let us cool out in Europe. You know, we have family and friends in Europe. Let us, you know, spend some time there to just get our heads away from what we have experienced. And a few moments before that trip to Europe, Spafford was kind of sidetracked or sidelined by some business that he had. And Anna, his wife, and the girls went ahead of him, sailing on the ocean liner SS Ville de Haer. But on November 21, 1873, which would be, as I said, 2 years after the fire, the liner, the same ship, was rammed by another British vessel and sank in minutes. Anna was picked up, which is his wife, unconscious on a floating spar, I guess a piece of board or something from the ship. And the four children, four girls, had drowned. What a devastating incident for Spafford and his family. I'm sure many of us would be completely out of our minds if something of this magnitude was to happen to us today, much less to write a song of that kind that he did after this incident. Because it was after this incident, or based on what transpired in this incident, why Spafford penned those lines. You know, as I reflect, I can't even begin to imagine what he and his family might have been going through mentally, emotionally, and even spiritually I know the questions would have come. Why us? Why now? 2 years ago, I witnessed or I experienced some tragedy. And now again, an even worse tragedy, an even greater tragedy of losing my 4 young children and my wife almost lost as well in that situation. Added to this, because the story doesn't end there. Added to this, the couple eventually ended up having 3 children after this incident. And, you know, Spafford named the only son that he had at that time. Because, as I said earlier, Spafford had 4 girls and those 4 girls perished. So now he had 3 eventually. He had 3 more children with his wife, Anna. And guess what? Tragedy struck again. One of the children, the only boy who was named after Spafford, Horatio was his name, died of scarlet fever. So imagine the only son. And maybe Spafford was looking forward to the son carrying on. Not only his name, but his legacy. Not that the girls couldn't have carried it on, but Spafford, I guess, even in naming his son after him, was looking forward to something bigger in his son. But then again, tragedy struck. Scarlet fever took his only son. What a roller coaster life for Spafford. Or for the Spaffords, because it's not only Horatio who wrote the hymn, but his wife as well. And even the other daughters who remained after the incident, or after the second set of children. I'm sure that they went through a lot of pain. What would you do, or what would you have done? What would you have felt, or even thought? In this situation, again, I can't even begin to imagine what the Spaffords would have felt, thought of, or even considered based on all that was happening to them at the time. And you know, in looking at Spafford's story, it reminds me of the story of Job. But I won't be speaking about that story or that account this morning. I'll be focusing on another account. Though it may not seem to have the same level of loss as with Spafford's account or with Spafford's story. But the story of Joseph was another story that, you know, basically spoke to some amount of loss, disappointments, and all of that along the way. And you know, I have been reading the Old Testament recently, and the account of Joseph has brought perspective on many levels. His account is recorded in Genesis 37 to 50. It takes up a significant portion of the book of Genesis. From chapter 37 to 50. Quite a significant section. Probably one of the most significant account in the Genesis book in terms of length of verses, aside from even Abraham's account. And I just want to read just a portion of that account in Genesis 37, 12 to 36. It is a very well-known account of how Joseph was basically betrayed by his brothers. So, in Genesis 37, this account is given of how Joseph, who was loved by his father, even above his brethren, his brothers. His brothers at the time knew that he was loved. And so, I'm going to read verse 12 to 36 quickly for us. 36. Just to remind us of that story of Joseph and how he was betrayed, even though he wouldn't have done anything to deserve it. Now his brothers had gone in graze to graze their father's flocks near to Shechem. And Israel said to Joseph, "As you know, your brothers are grazing the flocks near Shechem. Come, I am going to send you to them." "Very well," he replied. And I'm reading from the New International Version. So he said to him, "God, and go and see if all is well with your brothers and with the flocks, and bring word back to me." Then he sent him off from the valley of Hebron. When Joseph arrived at Shechem, a man found him wandering around the fields and asked him, "What are you looking for?" He replied, "I'm looking for my brothers. Can you tell me where they are grazing their flocks?" "They have moved on from here," the man answered. "I heard them saying, 'Let's go to Dothan.'" So Joseph went after his brothers and found them near Dothan. But they saw him in the distance, and before he reached them, they plotted to kill him. "Here comes the dreamer," or "Here comes that dreamer," they said to each other. "Come now, let's kill him and throw him into one of these cisterns and say that a ferocious animal devoured him. Then we'll see what comes of his dreams." When Reuben heard this, he tried to rescue him from their hands. "Let us not take his life," he said. "Don't shed any blood. Throw him into the cistern here in the wilderness, but don't lay a hand on him." Reuben said this to rescue him from them and take him back to his father. So when Joseph came to his brothers, they stripped him of his robe, the ornate robe he was wearing, and they took him and threw him into the cistern. The cistern was empty. There was no water in it. As they sat down to eat their meal, they looked up and saw a caravan of Israelites coming from Gilead. Their camels were loaded with spices, balms, myrrh, and they were on their way to take them down to Egypt. Judah said to his brothers, "What will we gain if we kill our brother and cover his blood? Come, let us sell him to the Ishmaelites and not lay our hands on him. After all, he is our brother, our own flesh and blood." His brothers agreed. So when the Midianite merchants came by, his brothers pulled Joseph up out of the cistern and sold him for 20 shekels of silver to the Ishmaelites, who took him to Egypt. When Reuben returned to the cistern, he saw that Joseph was not there. He tore his clothes. He went back to his brothers and said, "The boy isn't there. Where can I turn now?" Then they got Joseph's robe, slaughtered a goat, and dipped the robe in blood. Then they took the ornate robe back to their father and said, "We found this. Examine it to see whether it is your son's robe." He recognized it and said, "It is my son's robe. Some ferocious animal has devoured him. Joseph has surely been torn to pieces." Then Jacob tore his clothes, put on sackcloth, and mourned for his son many days. All his sons and daughters came to comfort him, but he refused to be comforted. "No," he said, "I will continue to mourn until I join my son in the grave." So his father wept for him. Meanwhile, The Midianites sold Joseph in Egypt to Potiphar, one of Pharaoh's officials, the captain of the guard. So, as you would hear from this story, and I know I wouldn't have the time to go into all the nuances of the story, but Joseph had a dream that he would be elevated and that his brothers would, in a sense, and even his family would bow to him. And his brothers were threatened by this dream, and so they sold him to the Ishmaelites. And then Joseph was later sold to the Egyptians. But the truth is, though they touched him, or though they attempted to even think of slaying him, the hand of God was with Joseph, even in the turmoil, even in the plans and the plots of the enemy, even his very brothers. The Lord was still with Joseph. And if we can go a little deeper into the Joseph account, we will realize that Joseph was placed in the home of Potiphar, and the Lord prospered Joseph to the point where he found favor with Potiphar. However, as he began to prosper, we know of the account of Potiphar's wife who wanted to lay with Joseph, and he refused. And then this spiraled Joseph into another turmoil of being thrown into prison because he was accused of seeking to rape Potiphar's wife. However, Joseph still remained faithful in prison and interpreted the dreams of the butler and the baker. But he did not receive a reprieve until two full years later, the Bible says, when he was finally remembered by the butler because of Pharaoh's dream. So Joseph also encountered a series of unfortunate events. And as I said earlier, based on the account given in Genesis, he didn't deserve it. He did nothing to deserve it. But despite the pain he felt during the various ordeals, the Lord was with him and he favored him. There was certainly purpose in Joseph's pain. Many of us today are facing similar challenges, some possibly more than even what Joseph faced, or even more than what Spafford endured. Spafford went on to write the very famous hymn, among doing many other things to elevate Christendom in Jerusalem. In the same way, Joseph went on to save generations of people, including his brothers that betrayed him. You are facing very challenging times at the moment, and it seems almost impossible to make it through. But I am saying to us this morning, let us not give up, because by God, there is purpose in our pain. Joseph also acknowledged this purpose in Genesis 50 verse 20 when he said, "But as for you, ye thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive." So Joseph recognized in Genesis 50. So from the account given in Genesis 37 to Genesis 50, it would have been a long time would have elapsed. That was a time when Joseph really looked back and realized that because of the turmoil that he went through, there was still purpose in it, because he was able to save many persons. Many of the entire children of Israel came through this process of saving because of Joseph's pain and anguish. It led to purpose in the end. So despite the plans of the enemy, the darts, the attacks, and whatever is thrown at us daily, illness will come, heartaches will come, disappointments will come, broken relationships will also come, financial embarrassment will come, among many other challenges that we will face in this life. But when they do present themselves, let us reassure ourselves that there is purpose in our pain. But you know, I want to make it very clear though, that when I refer to purpose, it will not always be the elevation story Joseph experienced, because it really boils down to the reason why we are going through what we do and the source of it. But as I'm seeing, someone is saying, purpose will never die. Sometimes some of us are disobedient and need to be straightened out. Sometimes we are going through a pruning to build us up. And other times, it's just like Joseph's case, where we are being, where whatever we are going through is being worked out for not just the greater good of for us, but it's being worked out for the greater good of impacting the lives of many others. Because when we go through these turmoil and tragic situations, as especially as Christians, and I'm speaking to the Christians this morning, God is with us. The Lord told us. No, sorry, He did not just tell us. He promised us that He would never leave us nor forsake us. Whether we go through the flood, whether we go through the fire, in the deepest valley, in the highest of hills or mountain situations, He is with us. Just as He stood with Joseph, so too He will stand with us and lift us up in due time. I know it's not easy. I know it's very difficult. And it is sometimes easier for us to become disheartened when we face these trials and tests in our lives, especially as children of God. But as I conclude this morning, and as I encourage you this morning, I am encouraging myself that we should trust the process that we are going through. Trust the process that you are going through. Purpose can't die. And if the Lord allowed whatever that is happening to you now, it is being allowed for a purpose. As I said earlier, it may be to put us back on the right track. It may be for pruning. And also, it may be for helping others who we will encounter to impact their lives and help them to change and to turn to God. So, despite the challenges, let us seek to serve Him diligently. And at the end of the day, we will be able to sing, just as Pafford did, "It is well with our souls." I'm just going to read just a couple verses of the song, of the hymn, just quickly. This is not very long. Just put us right back to where Spafford was. But he was able to say at the end of the day, "It is well with his soul." I don't know why he went through what he went through. I don't know if Spafford was disobedient. I don't know if it was a case that he was being pruned, or it was just for the greater good of many of us. But I know that because of the lyrics that are penned, it has helped a lot of persons across the world to go through the storms that they have faced. So he faced a storm back then, from the 1870s to 1880s and beyond. But this song has remained, even to this day in 2021, as an account and as a testimony that we too, even despite the challenges, can sing "It Is Well With Our Soul." When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like a sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul. Though Satan should buffet through the trials, though the trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ hath regarded my helpless estate, and hath shed his own blood for my soul. Let me read another. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. It can be well. It is well with our souls if we just hold on, if we continue to hold on to what the Lord is doing in our lives. To be confident that even though we face these turmoil and tragic situation, the Lord is in the midst of it to elevate us in due time. Let us pray. Holy God and righteous Father, we know that you are God. We know how great you are, and we praise your name this morning. We give you thanks, Lord, for life. We give you thanks for the blessing of health, strength, and the ability to share in this manner. Though we are far apart, you have joined us on this platform in this way and in this season that we are going through. Lord, we are faced with so much tumultuous situations. COVID is rising. Crime is also on the increase. There are many personal situations that we are faced with as your people, Lord. Pains and aches, financial woes, challenges with our families, challenges with our children, challenges with the very things that we sought after, the job, the vehicle, whatever. But Lord, we know, we have been assured through your word this morning that there is purpose in our pain. And despite what we may face, Lord, we know that you are with us. So Lord, help us to acknowledge this. Help us to recognize this. Help us to realize that, Lord, you are with us. In those moments when we feel like giving up, Lord, may you send the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, to be with us, to guide us, to comfort us in those moments. Lord, I pray that even now, those who are on this platform this morning and are going through very grievous situations, situations where they don't know what to do, where to turn, Lord, help them to find a solution. But even in finding a solution, Lord, help them to recognize that you were there, you are there, you continue to be there in all that they face, in all that we face daily, hourly, minutely, monthly, yearly. Whatever we face, whatever the gravity of what we face, you are with us. And as children of God, we know that we can cling to your promises because they are true. We are not a man, as Brother Dove said yesterday, that you should lie. No. So Lord, we know that once you said it, it shall be done, as your word has confirmed it. So Lord, we pray that you'll just give us grace. Give us the ability to exercise that fruit of the Spirit, which is called long-suffering. Lord, that is a fruit of the Spirit that many of us don't want to portray or to show. All the others sound so much more glorious. Peace, joy, love. But Lord, long-suffering comes at times that we must demonstrate it. So Lord, give us patience in our pain so that we can see the purpose in the pain. So Lord, this morning as I leave everything in your hands, I pray that you will hear the prayer even of those who are on this morning, who are going through difficult situations. I pray, Lord, even if these situations happening in our country, that Lord, you will intervene and that you will give us the ability to see beyond the pain, see beyond the turmoil, and be able to elevate you above everything that we face today, tomorrow, and whenever else we may face them. So, but Lord, we give you thanks and we give you praise that your Son Jesus Christ would have died for us so that we may have a greater hope, because as your word said, if in this life, if only in this life we have hope in Christ, then we are of men most miserable. So Lord, we look forward to a day when all this pain, the pain of death, the pain of illness, the pain of financial turmoil, all of this pain will be gone one day. But as we look forward to that day, help us to go through in grace. Help us, Lord, to go through knowing that we have a purpose on this earth, and that we ought to, all of us, ought to be sharing your word with others in whatever ways we can. If it's even a Facebook post, if it's even a WhatsApp message, let us remember that though we look forward to a day when we no longer face pain, that we have great work to do even now. So Lord, I leave today in your hands, and I bless you for each and everyone who has joined, who will join on whatever platform in the future. In your holy and righteous name I pray. Amen and amen. So I just want to say blessings to you all. I want to thank you for joining me once more, and I just pray that you will not only look at the pain that you are going through, but that you will look at the greater purpose which is behind the pain. So let us work towards shifting our focus, not on the pain so much, but on the purpose and on the God of our purpose, because he is able to do exceeding abundantly above all we could ever ask or think. So blessings each and everyone, and I hope you have a wonderful rest of Friday morning and day. Blessings.